Everyone, I'm Jen, and I'm here with Chris.
Hello.
He is going to show us Karangabasana today, but we are going to attempt to break it up into feasible steps. So, with Karangabasana, at this point, you should already be able to do a lotus, but you perhaps have not done lotus upside down with no hands before. So that's an important step. But also, this is not a pose that I would teach to somebody who does not have a solid Pinchamayarasana, because if you can't solidly hold Pinchamayarasana, then Karangabasana is really not in the realm of possibility yet. Because obviously, if you can't hold Pinchamayarasana, getting your legs into lotus when you're trying to do Pinchamayarasana is not super likely to happen. So, I'm going to assume that you can do Pinchamayarasana at this point, but if you cannot, working Pinchamayarasana from like a forearm plank can be really helpful for developing that strength. So first step would be to have Pinchamayarasana. The second thing that I typically have students do once they have Pinchamayarasana is work on getting into half lotus from a headstand. So Chris, could you show that from like a tripod headstand perhaps?
Yeah.
Just because getting into the lotus upside down can be really disorienting at first. So just getting familiar with getting into lotus, no hands. Because when we're in shoulder stand, frequently people use their hands. And then from here, beginning to work on learning the movement of lowering the lotus down, like you would do Karangabasana, except a little bit easier for a lot of people here, and lifting it back up. And then unwinding the legs and lowering all the way back down. Perfect, thank you. So that would be the first thing that I have people work on, and sometimes that takes a while because getting into lotus with no hands can be really challenging for people. One of the things I suggest for when you're trying to get into lotus with no hands is coming into a really deep external rotation and then bringing one foot in pretty dynamically at a time. But for me personally, getting into a deep external rotation and opening my legs a little bit apart from each other can be really helpful. So I'll have Chris show that in the next one. So the next one I'll have him do from Pinchamayarasana, like a true Karangabasana, but he can just kind of work on getting into the lotus and then maybe lowering a small part of the way down, but we won't even go beyond halfway yet. And then can you actually get into Pincha first from going to the forearm plank? We'll kind of break down Pincha. So if somebody's learning Pincha, usually I have them start here and just work on gaining strength. And then what they would do is walk the feet toward the elbows. So they're starting to get into the alignment of Pinchamayarasana with the hips being just about over the shoulders. And then from here, you could start working into Pinchamayarasana. And then you can spend a lot more time on any one of those steps than Chris just did. Okay, so Chris, go into a big external rotation and look at how he's opening his legs. Like, they're several feet apart now. Right leg in, left leg in. And then Chris, we'll lower a little bit of the way down, maybe about halfway, and then back up. And then stay there, Chris, and now since he can come that distance, he could lower a little bit closer to his arms. And then, well, he could lower all the way down. And then he can also come all the way back up. But that's gonna be hard for a lot of people. Go ahead and rest for a second, Chris. Okay, so basically what I would have somebody do at this point is lower to their point of control in the lotus and then bring it back up. And then lower to their point of control in the lotus and then bring it back up. And then start to work on lowering all the way down so that the legs touch the arms and then bringing it back up. Now, even getting the legs to touch the arms for some people can be really awkward at first. So one of the things I like to have students do who aren't quite finding that big aponic tuck and curl, like, because the spine really has to coil to get the lotus to the back of the arms, is just to kind of start to work on it just from seated and coming into like this shape of Pinchamayarasana arms and working on tucking
So, I mean, I'm in Karandamasana, but obviously incorrect orientation here. But it does help with the hip flexor strength and learning the movement of tucking the knees all the way into the armpits, because it's actually a super deep engagement from the lowest abs. So that's another thing that I'll have students do in preparation for Karandavasana. Okay, so we have those two things, and then basically you just kind of keep working all the way down. Now, once somebody is able to lower all the way down, I have them hold it before they even really worked on coming back up, because coming back up is obviously way more difficult with gravity working against you in this direction, but lowering down very slowly with gravity helping you is really helpful. And then I'll frequently just have students hold it as long as they can and really feel like they were pushing off the floor. But one of the key things is that once you're really working in both directions, if you ever totally settle your weight onto the forearms and like let the weight drop, then it becomes that much more difficult to lift it back up. So staying in that point where you're almost hovering off your arms and the weight is always kind of lifting up rather than dropping down makes coming back up way easier. So since it's so hard, I don't want to make Chris do it like 100 times. So I'll try to point out everything that I can in this last one. So this will be the last one. Okay. You good for one more?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Alright, so solid hinge up. He gets his legs easily. The sensation of drawing up through the low abdomen so that you're folding while you're continually drawing up. Curl in. I'll have students really push up here. I mean, Chris is already doing it, but not everyone does. And then uncoil. Uncoil, uncoil, uncoil. And so he makes it look easy, but there a lot of work went into that, and of course it typically does for anyone who's able to lower, and definitely for anyone who's able to lift. But I would say the key steps would be getting a really solid Majjhima-Virasana, working the headstand variation until you are able to get the legs into lotus and lower down and lift that up. Trying that again from Majjhima-Virasana, being able to lower to your point of control, where you're still able to lift it back up. Because if you're able again to lotus and then crashing down and maybe haphazardly landing on your arms is not, in my opinion, super productive. It's much better to lower down with control to your point of control. And then you can start learning the movement of taking it back up as well. And continuing to build that until you're lowering down much closer to your legs and being able to hopefully lift back up at that point. But learning how to lower down with fighting gravity as much as possible will train your muscles, the same muscles that you will eventually use to unravel and pull it all the way back up. So, did I miss anything? But it really just takes a lot of time and a lot of practice.
Practicing.
Practicing.